Agena Target Vehicle 5003 was launched on March 16, 1966 at 3 p.m. UTC from Launch Complex 14 at Cape Canaveral, 1 hour and 41 minutes before Gemini 8, which had the mission of rendezvousing and docking with the Agena. The Agena stage had an orbital mass of 3.175 tons, was placed in a roughly circular 300-kilometer orbit, and in later missions would demonstrate the capability of boosting the Gemini spacecraft into higher orbits with its substantial propellant. As it was, this mission was already overly ambitious without that element. After Neil Armstrong and Dave Scott docked Gemini 8 to the Agena, Scott was supposed to do an EVA, a spacewalk, over 2 hours long. This was only the second time the US would attempt a spacewalk, and Scott was supposed to get an experiment from Gemini's adapter, fiddle with another experiment on the Agena, test a power tool, and finally test a maneuvering unit. He would not get a chance to do that EVA though. With that plan in mind, however, Gemini 8 launched on time at 4:41 p.m. UTC from Launch Complex 19 at Cape Canaveral, one orbit behind the Agena, getting into a lower orbit with an apoapsis around 300 kilometers to match the Agena, but a periapsis at 160 kilometers. This allowed for a rendezvous and docking in a mere 5.5 hours, which the two astronauts, both on their first space flight, managed without any apparent trouble. It was the first docking between two spacecraft, a key accomplishment on the road to Apollo. The taste of success was short-lived, however. Mission Control warned Gemini 8 that they were suspicious of the Agena's attitude control system shortly before a communication blackout, advising the crew to undock if anything went wrong. When the combination of the two craft started tumbling, stopping when the crew fired thrusters to control it but then starting up again, Gemini 8 was out of communication with the ground. The crew decided to undock to analyze the situation since they couldn't be sure which spacecraft was at fault, and Dave Scott had the presence of mind to also return control of the Agena to the ground, which would allow it to be used again on the Gemini 10 mission. As it turned out, the problem was with the Gemini spacecraft itself. A thruster kept firing due to an electrical short, and undocking meant that the now lighter craft was tumbling at a much faster and ever-increasing rate. Since the problem was with the OMS system, the Orbital Attitude and Maneuvering System, in the adapter section, Armstrong decided to turn that system off and activate the reaction control system in the nose of the spacecraft, which was used for re-entry. To do so ended the mission according to the mission rules, which demanded an immediate return to the surface once the re-entry thrusters were activated, so Armstrong didn't make that decision lightly. The rotation rate was so high that it was generating more than 4 g's of acceleration, and the astronauts would soon be at risk of losing consciousness. Armstrong's decision stabilized the situation, but he had used most of the re-entry thruster propellant. Mission Control decided to stick with the mission rules, with the quickest return available being in about 4 hours, cutting the overall mission to 10 hours instead of the originally planned 3 days. This was the first serious incident during a crewed mission for NASA, and led to the creation of the procedures to investigate such failures. These procedures would tragically be put to use within a year, when 3 astronauts died during the Apollo 1 fire. A side effect of the mission was that Dave Scott and NASA had not been able to discover that their EVA expectations were wildly optimistic. That revelation was left for Gene Cernan in Gemini 9A, and then NASA had to scramble to figure EVAs out, managing it by the last mission in the program, Gemini 12. Thank you for watching this mission profile of Gemini 8.